next award is the Dental Public Health Award, and this award has been established by the Indian Association of Public Health Dentistry with the aim of recognizing merit and encouraging talent in public health dentistry. And it's given for distinguished work carried out by the nominee during the preceding 3 years and published in a peer-reviewed national and international journal specifically related to public health dentistry. And this year's awardee is Dr. Soumendra Vikram Singh, who is Associate Professor of the Department of Prosthodontics at KGMU Lucknow. Dr. Singh, please.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, respected chairpersons, respected seniors and friends. The article on which I am going to get that I have received this prestigious award is the prevalence of dental myths, oral hygiene methods and tobacco habits in an aging North Indian rural population, which was published in Gerodontology with an impact factor of 2. Villages constitute a large part of India and need to be given due attention for dental health education and awareness programs. This investigation was therefore conducted in a rural area, targeting the aged as our study population, presuming they would be more dependent on rural dental awareness and care facilities. Our aim was to evaluate the level of dental awareness and education by assessing the prevalence of dental myths, oral hygiene methods and tobacco use. A dental myth normally arises from a traditional belief of non-scientific base or from unqualified and untrained dental professionals called quacks, who unfortunately may be the only recourse for treatment for a rural resident. Over a period of generations, such ideas become ingrained in the psyche of many individuals and pose a threat to the acceptance of scientific and modern dental treatment. Tobacco was introduced in India in the 16th century approximately, is smoked, chewed, and applied locally over teeth and gums as a toothpaste. Though peer pressure is an important cause of tobacco initiation, many people in rural India get addicted to tobacco, this is an interesting fact, while using it for the alleviation of tooth-related pain. This study was conducted in a group of 10 villages situated within a radius of 14 kilometers from Lucknow city after obtaining ethical clearance and permission from the village elders. Of the 800 individuals aged above 50 years, 681 formed the study sample after recording their individual informed consents. Separate team of investigators, accompanied by the village elders or their representatives, approached the subjects on a door-to-door basis with close-ended multiple-choice questions. These were based on the available literature and were presented in Hindi and concentrated on the awareness of oral hygiene, methods to maintain it, presence of tobacco habits, and prevalence of myths. If a subject was illiterate, questions were read out with options one by one, verbal responses being recorded. Information about the subjects was calculated in the following groups, with as the number of the group increased, so did the qualification or the age. The clinical examination was brief, comprising of counting the visibly non-carious, non-mobile teeth with antagonists present. Our results were 40% of the sample did not consider oral hygiene necessary. The average number of sound teeth in subjects who considered oral hygiene necessary was 20, which was significantly higher than those who did not. 36% of subjects in the younger age group considered oral hygiene necessary, compared to 48% in the oldest age group. Oral hygiene methods most predominantly were mouth rinsing and finger brushing, 61%, followed by the use of dantoon, 21%, and then tooth brushing. In the younger ages and higher educational groups, toothbrushing was more common. The average number of teeth when correlated with the different oral hygiene methods were 15 in mouth rinsing, 23 with dantun, and 25 with brushing. Tobacco use in the study sample was 76% in males, and 48% of the total subjects smoked or chewed tobacco. The average number of teeth in subjects who did not use tobacco was significantly higher in subjects who used it in one form or the other. The common dental myths in the study sample were: tooth loss is a natural outcome of aging, tobacco consumption prevents caries or periodontitis, dental diseases are curable solely by medicines, professional dental cleaning causes loosening of teeth, and extraction of teeth leads to weakening of eyesight. 81% of the study population had one dental myth or the other. Oral hygiene awareness and practice differs from country to country, community to community, and a rural area would presumably present a different picture from an urban one. Unfortunately, little, if any, epidemiological data is available in India about our rural communities. The present work was carried out with this aim. The aging population, as I have said earlier, was targeted because they presumably would reflect locally held beliefs better compared to the youth who migrate often to urban areas for job opportunities. The study showed that the use of dantun or tree twig chewing is still popular in rural India, and though it is inferior to toothbrushing, its massaging action possibly makes it a more satisfactory option than finger brushing or mouth rinsing. Its disadvantages include gingival trauma and flattening of teeth by attrition. The study showed marked ignorance, lack of dental awareness, high prevalence of tobacco habits and dental myths in the study sample, more marked in the older, less educated, and female subjects. The high prevalence of dental myths would prevent such individuals from obtaining appropriate dental care, even if made available to them. Therefore, efforts should be made to organize home-to-home, door-to-door awareness programs, considering that such individuals may be incapable or unwilling to commute for economic, motivational, or health-related causes. The limitations of the study were a written questionnaire being presented to a largely illiterate population, which was therefore delivered in a verbal style, which may have been missed out by the illiterate subject. Also, a subject honestly handling the myth, hygiene, and habit-related questions could be a question in a face-to-face interview. Future studies could benefit by focusing on a more qualitative interpretation of what the rural aged understand about the basic concepts of health, disease, and hygiene. So, to sum it up, the subjects were largely ignorant about their oral needs, with 40% of the subjects considering oral hygiene unnecessary. Lack of dental awareness was shown by 61% of the sample, relying on simple mouth rinsing or finger brushing for maintaining oral hygiene, the high prevalence of tobacco habits and dental myths. The result showed that a targeted program to spread the scientific dental practices is required. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Any questions?
What kind of targeted practices for this kind of would you advocate? Door to door, does it seem to be very much a feasible program for each particular kind of message?
I agree with you, sir. It's easier said than done. Though the next part of this study has also been completed, where we actually targeted this population, and we found that various hospitals, etc., which were even available to these patients, which were nearby in a 2 to 4 kilometer radius, they were not going there. But once we tried to dispel their myths and talk to them about whatever awareness issues were there, we noticed a significant increase in the number of patients reporting to such populations, to such hospitals.
On behalf of the Academy, we request you to kindly receive the medal, the scroll and the check.